You may be seated. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die." On behalf of the family, I want to thank you all for coming this afternoon. My name is Barry Taylor. I'm the lead pastor here at First Free Methodist, and Pastor Patty is our family pastor here, and we'll be officiating today. And we are here today to celebrate the life of Shelley Bader. We come to times like this with a mix of emotions. There's sorrow and sadness as we grieve, and then there's feelings of compassion and goodness and thankfulness as we think of the wonderful times we shared. And there's also moments of laughter as we reflect on the many moments of great fun and joy shared with Shelley. And I want to remind everyone this morning, or this afternoon, that we serve a God who calls us to love him with all of who we are. As Jesus was talking to his disciples, he said, "Love God with all your hearts, minds, soul, and strength." And so that mix of emotion is fully appropriate for us in days like today as we remember. And it's how God wants us to come to him, just all of who we are. Let's pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you have created us. Open up our hearts to your presence this day. Assure us, Holy Spirit, that the one we serve, Jesus, has conquered death and lives forever. Just help us today to see our lives as temporary through the light of eternity. And as we do that, our spirits can grow calm and you can give us clearer vision. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I had the privilege of getting to know Shelley more moving here to Moose Jaw in 2011. And then as she came on staff as our administrator, and one of the things that anyone that knows Shelley knows, that she loves to worship, she loves music. And so there's a great number of great hymns and songs today in this funeral service. Just by way of explanation, for those of you that are in closer quarters, you're welcome to sing, but we just ask that you keep your mask on. And at this time, we're going to join in singing a great hymn of the faith, "I Know Whom I Have Believed." You're please invite to stand to sing.
I know not why God's wondrous grace to me he hath made known, nor why unworthy Christ in love redeemed me for his own. But I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. I know not how this saving faith to me he did impart, nor how believing in his word wrought peace within my heart. But I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. I know not how the Spirit moves, convincing men of fear, nor if I walk the veil with him or meet him in the air. But I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day.
You may be seated.
The scripture reading this afternoon is from John chapter 14, verses 1 to 6. And I'm going to be reading from the New King James Version. It says this: "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, and how can we know?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me."
I invite you to stand again, and we're going to sing another hymn when we all get to heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place.
When we all
get to heaven,
what a day of rejoicing
that will be.
When we all
see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay.
When we all get to heaven,
what a day of rejoicing that will be.
When we all see Jesus,
we'll sing and shout the victory.
Onward to the prize before us,
soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold.
When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing
that will be.
When we all see Jesus,
we'll sing and shout the victory.
You may be seated.
We don't want to mix up our masks. Before we start, I didn't even have this plan, but I was going to say that singing these old hymns, Shelley and I used to talk about how much we miss the old hymns nowadays. We're getting lots of new ones, and so I'm just happy to see these and hear these and sing these. So amazing. And I'm just going to point out that this young lady here beside me, my sister, is also battling cancer, and she has a bad cough because of the cancer in her lungs. So if she's coughing, it's nothing to do with anything.
Don't run.
It's just that. Okay, so we'll start off. Who was Shelley? Well, she was my cousin. Only a few months separated us in age. She was my friend and my confidant, and over the years, we helped each other raise perfect children. We solved all the world's problems. We cried together, we grieved together, but always, 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 we laughed together.
What is the first thing that comes to mind when you think about Shelley? It has to be that incredible, infectious laugh of hers. Shelley had one of those laughs that you couldn't help but laugh along with. And of course, as cousins, we did our share of laughing.
Here we The Campbells are coming, hurrah, hurrah. The Campbells are coming, hurrah, hurrah. The Campbells are coming was our theme song as we anticipated the arrival of our cousins at Grandma's house. Now, Grandma's house was at the edge of a Swift Current Creek and actually on a pretty steep cliff. We were always warned not to go near the creek as it was dangerous. But we all knew, the four of us, the fearless four, Shelley, Heather, Myra, and I, knew that we were up to the task. But on one occasion, if someone hadn't climbed a tree at the creek's edge and fallen out of it, not to mention any names, Myra, no one would have been any of the wiser. But Myra, Myra ran crying back to Grandma's house, and that's when the trouble began. Our dad reminded us of the rule, and then, had the four of us lean over Grandma's coffee table, bottoms up, to prepare for a spanking, which, by the way, in those days was perfectly legal. However, four crying little girls, actually Shelley was wailing and pleading, bent over the table, made my dad laugh so hard, and he cried, and we never did get punished. We had many visits over the years at Grandma's.
Time was spent playing games, climbing the trees onto the roof of the house, much to Grandma's and our parents' chagrin. We would use long pieces of grass to scare whoever was using the outhouse by tickling that person with the grass stuck through a knot hole in the side of the outhouse. And then there was that dreaded dirt basement biffy that could be used in the winter if you were brave enough to go down there in the cobweb-infested dungeon that obviously hid monsters and many other evil things that our minds could think of. There was one memorable night at Grandma's. The four of us girls were up in Aunt Weena's bedroom on New Year's Eve playing a board game and waiting for midnight to come. Now, Grandma lived near the railroad tracks, and at that time, trains pulled in at midnight and all blew their horns. Well, as usual, we were all laughing and being crazy. Shelley had to go to the bathroom, but she didn't want to miss out on the game or the welcoming in of the new year. Well, midnight came, and we were all intent on our game, so we were startled when the train whistles blew, and we all broke out laughing. Well, apparently Shelley should have gone to the bathroom, although wetting the pants made us laugh even harder and made for a great memory.
In March of her grade 9 year, Uncle Archie and Aunt Donna were transferred to Ontario. Shelley stayed behind in Regina at her Uncle Wilf and Aunt Greta's place to finish her school year. During that time, I had to go to Regina to be fitted for a pair of orthopedic shoes. Now, these things were ugly, and I mean ugly, and they cost $75. And being a fashion-conscious teen, I was mortified that I had to wear them. Anyway, Mom made arrangements to pick up Shelley and take us both out for supper. At the restaurant, Mom went on and on about the shoes, and particularly the cost of them. Well, at one point, Shelley bent over and looked under the table, sat back up and said, "You paid $75 for those?" Then, realizing what she had said, she turned a bright shade of red and looked at my mom for her reaction. I started laughing, and of course, Shelley joined in, and we didn't stop.
We also spent time out at the cabin at Arlington Beach. We played games and laughed until we could hardly breathe. We would scream at the moths that would fly in and buzz the lanterns. We snuck out at night and ran over to Aunt Green and Uncle Wilf's cabin. There was lots of swimming, of course. Well, never on Sunday, and of course, always an hour after eating. Dawn, being the older cousin, would take us out on boat rides. We also enjoyed Shelley's piano playing. We were amazed at how gifted she was, and we really enjoyed our sing-alongs, mostly hymns and camp songs. Shelley and Ron's wedding was a beautiful affair and was made especially memorable by the wooden Coke box that Shelley had to stand on so the photographer could take a picture of them. After a few years of marriage, they were blessed with a precious baby girl they named Melissa, followed a few years later by a baby boy named Matthew. Their family was complete, and Shelley loved being a mom and all the bragging rights that came with it.
For a brief time when Shelley and Ron were in Swift Current, Shelley and I would get together for coffee. I remember when they moved into that big, beautiful home on Battleford Trail. I was so excited to see it, and I offered to help unpack. Well, Shelley insisted. No, she wanted to do it. Well, month after month, when I'd go over for coffee, I'd stop by the house, and the unpacked boxes still littered the house. I'll just leave it there. She did, however, have a theme for her new house. Apples, apples everywhere. I don't know where she found half of the apple-themed knickknacks, but some of them stayed with her to the end. And I see that there's one here because I was going to say I know that she planned her own funeral, and I'm almost surprised that she didn't pick an apple-shaped urn. As we married and started our families, we weren't in regular contact, but whenever we did get together, we didn't miss a beat.
We sure didn't. We often laughed about the time that Mavis had a medical test in Regina early in the morning, so we decided to stay in Moose Jaw overnight. Heather came to town, and the four of us were to go for supper and an evening of visiting. Mavis and I weren't familiar with the hotels in Moose Jaw, and so we booked one on the highway so we'd be ready to go in the morning. That was the days before Google. You had to look it up in the Yellow Pages. Well, this turned out to be the grossest hotel either one of us had ever stayed in. I believe we slept on top of the covers because we were afraid what we would find. We were telling our tale of woe to Shelley and Heather, and Shelley said, "Well, I was wondering why you guys booked that. It doesn't have a very good reputation." So we said, "Like, well, now you tell us." We spent so much time laughing about the conditions of the hotel that night that we were almost sick. We actually came close to being kicked out of the restaurant for our behavior.
Now, I'm sure most of you will be shocked at this, but Shelley wasn't a morning person. You didn't want to call her too early. 10:30 p.m. seemed about the right time to call. Many a night, as I was savoring a bowl of popcorn in my jammies and watching a movie, nodding off, my phone would ring, and I knew I wouldn't get to bed very early that night. I often toyed with the idea, however, of getting even and calling her at 7 in the morning.
We have a strong family history of cancer. Our moms, Shelley and Heather, all had breast cancer. I have ovarian cancer because I like to be different. In 2015, I was a recipient of Cameco Touchdown for Dreams program. It was such an amazing honor. So in 2017, when Shelley was battling her cancer again, I suggested she apply for the program, and she was accepted. As far as I know, we were the only two relatives in the program. Shelley and her kids and grandkids ended up going to Cuba, a memory I'm sure they will all cherish. Because we were both battling cancer, we spent time over the phone and in person laughing and also sharing our journey and our faith. We discussed death and dying at length and looked forward to going to heaven and seeing our loved ones there.
So Shelley was an overcomer. She survived lots of adversity. She lost her parents and her husband very early in her life. She battled cancer and diabetes. And the thing that carried her through it all was her faith and her love for her family. She was able to see both her children grow and delighted in her four grandchildren. And her children, grandchildren, and siblings meant everything to her, as did her faith. My last conversation with Shelley was a week before she passed away. I had phoned her on the Wednesday, and on Friday she called me. I think it was because she hit redial, and I was the last person who had called her. Sorry, I'm not there. She was a little upset, but after we talked for a few minutes, she seemed to calm down. And I told her that Meyer and I were allowed to come and visit and that we would be there the following week. She said, "That will be nice. I always feel so good when you guys leave." Myra, Heather, and I had a good laugh about that, and had Shelley been a little more alert, I think she'd have laughed the hardest. Shelley is now pain-free, laughing and reuniting with her loved ones.
We were thankful to be able to get to Davidson the night before the Lord took Shelley home. Shelley was unresponsive, but we were able to say our goodbyes and our love yous. Today, as we celebrate Shelley's life, we do not grieve as those who have no hope. We know that Shelley is laughing and singing in heaven with her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, whom she served faithfully all her life. Till we meet again, Shelley, we will continue to laugh and enjoy all our wonderful memories. You are free indeed.
Thank you, Myra and Mavis. And we're going to sing about seeing Jesus right now. I invite you to stand as we sing the song, "When We See Christ."
Oftentimes the day seems long, our trials hard to bear. We're tempted to complain, to murmur and despair. will soon appear to catch his bride away. All tears forever over in God's eternal day. It will be worth it all when we see Jesus. The trials will seem so small when we see Christ. One glimpse of his dear face, all sorrows will erase. So bravely run the race till we see Christ. Sometimes the skies look dark with not a ray of light. We're tossed and driven on, no human help in sight. But there is one in heaven who knows our deepest care. Let Jesus solve your problems, just come to him in prayer. It will be worth it all when we see Jesus. Life's trials will seem so small when we see Christ. One glimpse of his dear face, all sorrows will erase. So bravely run the race till we see Christ. Life's day will soon be o'er, all storms forever past. We'll cross the great divide to glory safe at last. We'll share the joys of heaven, a harp, a home, a crown. The tempter will be banished, we'll lay our burden down. It will be worth it all when we see Jesus. Life's trials will seem so small when we see Christ. One glimpse of his dear face, all sorrow will erase. So bravely run the race till we see Christ.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Let's say that you decide you're going to go camping. Yes, so you head on over to Canadian Tire and you buy one of those wonderful little canvas tents. And so you set the tent up in the backyard just to figure out how it all fits together, where all the pieces go. And you are happy and you're excited. And in this tent, you enjoy many adventures. Summer after summer after summer. Eventually you add some more camping gear and of course inflatables, and even though you love life in that tent, you're still happy when the time comes and you are delighted to go home. Ah, home. One day you take a look at that tent and you notice the corner where you had to get a special needle and kind of perform some needed surgery to fix up the spot where the pole hooked through, where the pole wore through. And then you look around and you see duct tape that was used to patch the wounds from the big storm many a year. And the poles could no longer be trusted to hold up the tent. So you had to rig them up with branches and do a little MacGyvering with bungee cords. And of course, tents get a little leaky, so you should go to the bathroom first. They get a little leaky, and you remember, camping, you remember somebody always yelling, "Don't touch the sides, don't touch the sides," because it would leak if you did. And so your tent, over the years, has some trouble. In 2 Corinthians 5, the Apostle Paul says that the human body is like a tent that we dwell in here on earth. And when it is worn out and discarded, we have faith to believe that God has another for us in heaven. And it will be a dwelling place that's made by God's hands, a permanent one that will last forever. Because we know that an earthly tent is temporary. So it'd be ridiculous to put up your tent and then back up the cement truck, beep, 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 and put in sidewalks and then do some landscaping, put in some flowers and bushes and build a big shed to keep all your inflatables. Because a tent is temporary. And so is the earthly body. This is the reality of the frailty of our human bodies. That's what Paul was talking about. He said it's just like a tent. It's temporary, inadequate, and it gets worn out over time. And while Shelley tented here on earth, she packed in a lot of adventures. She invited so many of us, her friends who became family and her family, to be with her at her side. I guess you could call us all in tents. That was for Shelley. What an adventurer and lover of life she was. Many of her friends and family were at her side, enjoying trips, movies, parties, suppers, Globe Theater, getaways, and of course, times at the place she loved, Arlington, with inflatables. In fact, there's a video that she loved of an older lady trying to get herself into a position on a giant pink flamingo and not being very successful. And Shelley said, that's what I look like. And she would laugh and laugh. She said, yeah, Melissa described her mom as vibrant because she loved to play and party and laugh. And there's a wonderful video that Cindy has. Go to her Facebook page. Shelley's playing speech jammer and trying to sing a song and laughing and laughing. What? Oh, psst, shh, shh. Pretend I didn't say that. Her tent was a place of refuge and acceptance. She was always careful to include everyone. And she was kind, very kind. While she worked at the church, Pastor Barry and I can attest to the fact of how she would come in the morning and she would apologize for losing it the day before. And we were both like, what now? What? Because, of course, we didn't realize that was a losing it. We hadn't noticed. She was also generous, driving out week after week to Avonlea to play the piano so they could have music in their worship service. That was a gift of love. And oh man, she loved extravagantly. First of all, her boys. Braden, Riley, Grayson, Riker, you are her world. You were her world. She loved you all. She often shared your sweet, funny, loving ways. And I believe that she lived as long as she did because of you and her little loves. We are all thankful for those extra years. And this is what she wanted. She wanted for you to be old enough to remember her. And I know that you will. You have lots of videos and pictures, so always remember how much she loved you. And she loved her children, Melissa and Matt, and later Kyle. She was very proud of you, and I can see why. You were there for her, especially in this last year, to lend support and care. And she was delighted and pleased with your choice of spouse, Kimber, Steve, Ashley. She's delighted. She spoke of it often. You guys are amazing. And she loved her siblings, Dawn, Heather, your spouses. She loved you all. Rosalie joined Dave and the rest of her nieces and nephews and relatives she loved. In fact, someone sent a letter for me to read, and her name is Deb Sprenger. We all knew this day would come, and some days we prayed Shelley into God's loving arms. Yes, we did. My mom reminded me that she prayed for Shelley 4 years through the cancer journey, 15 years. For the first few days after Shelley died, I just walked around going, 15 years. Shelley and I met at Christian Women's, this is back to the letter now. Shelley and I met at Christian Women's dinners when we found all that we shared in common, becoming sisters immediately. I was a new Canadian, and even when my husband JW and I moved back to the States, we kept in contact. We would all agree that Shelley was a giver. When preparing for today, my husband came across the following poem entitled Epitaph, and she says, "My heart is aching, but we know that Shelley is with her Lord and Savior." Here is the poem that she's written about the love that even though Shelley's gone, she has love. Her love is still here, and it's for us to give away. Here's what she's written. Here's what Merritt Malloy, the writer of this poem, has said. "When I die, give what's left of me away to children and old men that wait to die. And if you need to cry, cry for your brother walking the street beside you. And when you need me, put your arms around anyone and give to them what you need to give to me. I want to leave you something, something better than words or sounds. Look for me in the people I've known and loved. And if you cannot give me away, at least let me live in your eyes and not on your mind. You can love me most by letting hands touch hands and by letting bodies touch bodies and by letting go of children that just need to be free. Love doesn't die. People do. So when all that's left of me is love, give me away." She had many friends, I'm calling them camping buddies. And she set the example of how to be a friend. In the Bible, in Mark chapter 2, verses 1 to 5, it tells of four friends who so badly wanted their sick friend well that they carried their friend to the house where Jesus was. And when they arrived at the house, it was so packed full of people that they couldn't get in. So instead, they traipsed up the back to the roof, tore it apart, grabbed some rope, and lowered their friend in to see Jesus and to be healed. Shelley was that kind of friend. She would have grabbed a corner of that mat, and she would have helped carry somebody in need, even when she was in pain. Also, she had friends like that. You are her friends. You were there for her, and thank you. She wanted to say thank you to all of you. She wanted to throw a great big roast beef dinner and hire Charlotte's to come and feed you all to say thank you for how you've helped her. That we couldn't ever make that happen because she was never well enough when we realized it needed to happen. So maybe in a year from now, we'll all celebrate together and thank you. You were willing to do anything to see her health improve and be without pain. Lynn, she often talked of you and the healing IVs that you gave her. Many friends drove her for treatments and cared for her afterwards in so, so many ways. Late one evening, Shelley and I were talking on the phone, and she happened to be in incredible pain. So I was joking because I like to make her laugh, and she said she felt better when she laughed. So I was joking with her, and I said, you're in a lot of pain. Just say the word, and I will go next door, knock on the door, and buy some marijuana. And we laughed, of course, but after I hung up the phone, I realized, yeah, if she'd have said the word, I would have actually done that. Maybe I would have looked around, but pretty sure my neighbors have it. Yeah, I live in the hood. She wasn't just here on Earth for the fun time of a camping trip. While here, she served God gladly. Most important to Shelley was her faith in God. She believed in Jesus Christ. She believed that God is faithful with his promise that to be absent from the body is to be home. Ah, home. And to be present with her Lord. The music that she selected for us to sing today is all centered on that faith that was so strong for her. And she requested, it wasn't said anywhere, but I'm going to say it now. She requested that song that her nieces, Mary Joy and Vanessa, sang while that slideshow was running. That was their voices singing. We could say that Shelley was homesick to be with the Lord, and she looked forward to the day when her faith would be sight and she would be home. Ah. Home. The scripture that Cindy read for us describes how Jesus has prepared a place for all those who believe. Shelley held on to this hope, this faith, and she looked forward to a permanent place with God. Death is a time for mourning, but it's also a time for rejoicing. In Revelation 21, a vision of heaven is described. It says he will wipe away all tears from their eyes. There will be no more death, neither sorrow or mourning, and no more pain. The former things have all passed away. Driving home from Davidson the last time that I saw her, I imagined that after all she endured for 15 years and more, the place prepared for her would have the biggest, bestest, brightest, shiniest, most wonderful mansion at the end of that golden road. But then I thought, no, Jesus has prepared a place for her, for her. So now I see her place not as a mansion up on a hilltop, but as a perfect cabin down on that beautiful shore. Because just like any tent, Shelley wore out. After all, her body sustained surgeries, her wounds were patched up, she had parts missing, and she could no longer trust her legs to hold her up. And don't read too much into this, but her tent too, Don't touch the sides. It got a little leaky. So I see her with Jesus, where he takes her by the hand and leads her to the promised land beside still waters, to that beautiful shore where she is home. Ah, home. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Our merciful God and Father, like the words of the famous hymn, we stand here amazed in your presence. We thank you for your faithfulness and for the fruitfulness of the life of Shelley. We thank you that while this earth was her home, she lived a full life and left a legacy of example to cherish and many memories and wonderful stories that we will keep alive. Thank you for the example of a loving parent, sister, cousin, friend, and grandparent, and parent. She was supportive, helpful, artistic, creative, energetic, kind, and enthusiastic. We pray today for each one that her life will be an example and that will live on in them through the example that she has set. We pray for them as they cherish the memories and are thankful for the times they shared with her and for the good they saw in her and the love they received from her. Give us strength and courage to leave her in your care with confidence in your promise of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. We thank you for her fruitful life and for your faithful promise of the resurrection, where she experiences a peaceful passing into a new home in a new body. We thank you for all she now enjoys, for the absence of any pain, any tears, and any sorrow. Father, at this time we pray for those left behind to mourn her passing. We ask that you would give strength, comfort, rest, and peace in the days to come while we process this loss. We pray especially for her family. They were so special to her. May you grant your peace during the days and months to come. And we pray for her precious grandchildren. We know she loved them dearly. May they grow to cherish her memory and live out her legacy. God, our Father, we thank you that you sent your Son, Jesus, to die for us, come back to life again, that your cross declares your love to be without limit, your resurrection that death, our last enemy, is defeated. By your victory, we are assured of the promise that you will never leave us or forsake us, and that neither death nor life nor things present nor things to come can separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord and in Christ alone. Amen.
I invite you to stand as we sing that song, In Christ Alone. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid crown, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his. And he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath,
Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Maybe see that.
That the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Well, not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours. Who am I that the eyes that see my sin would look on me me rise again? Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. Because of what you've done, not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me That the Lord of all the earth would care to know.
You a good chuckle. Let us sing together a song that speaks of being in glory together. Oh, that will be glory. I invite you to stand as we sing this last hymn.
When all my labors and trials are o'er, and I am safe on that beautiful shore, just to be near the dear Lord I adore, will through the ages be glory for me. Oh, that will be, oh, that will glory, be for me. Glory for me, glory for me, glory for me, when by his grace I shall look on his face. That will be glory, be glory for me. When by the gift of his infinite grace I am accorded in heaven a place, just to be there and to look on his face, will through the ages be glory for me. Oh, that will be, oh, that will glory, be for me, glory 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 for me, when by his grace I shall look on his face. That will be glory for me. Friends will be there I have loved long ago. Joy like a river around me will flow. Yet just a smile from my Savior I know will through the ages be glory for me. Oh, that will be glory for me. Glory for me. Grace, I shall look on his face. That will be glory for me.
Thank you. You may be seated. So, a couple of announcements. When we're dismissed today, we ask you to wait until the family leaves. We're heading out for a family-only burial. So just wait for them, and then you're dismissed when an usher indicates that it's your turn to do so. If you want to drop by at 3 o'clock to meet Joy and Dave in Crescent Park by the library, they would welcome an opportunity for just a visit, a socially distanced outside visit at 3 o'clock. Did I get that right? Awesome. And Shelley was very sweet, and obviously she tasted to see that the Lord is good. So we want you to leave today with a taste that the Lord is good. So on your way out at those doors, when the ushers lead you out, Shelley's good friend Donna has a little treat, a little sweet, on Shelley's behalf in lieu of a reception that you can avail yourself of. And now, hear the benediction, the good word. God our Father, by raising Christ your Son, you destroyed the power of death and opened for us the way to eternal life. As we remember before you, our dear Shelley, we ask for your help for all who gathered in her memory. Grant us the assurance of your presence and grace by the Spirit you have given us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.